Welcome back to the Suraj Podcast. Today we are going to be concluding with the stories that relate to Bidhi Chand and his mission to steal horses from the Lahore Fort. In the previous episode, we talked about Bidhi Chand deceiving the entire fort there, Shah Jahan, the emperor, the other officers, Sondak Khan, and he had locked them all up. He had gotten the horse. On his way out, he gives a challenge to Shah Jahan, saying that, you know, if you want these horses, basically come get them. We're going to be, me and Guru Hargobind are going to be in the village of Bairupa. He tells his name there as well. He rides out in the similar manner as he did the first time, so jumping over the fort wall. He's going into the river and then swims across and rides out from there. So this portion of story, these stories that relate to Bidhi Chand stealing the horse, you can also find them in an earlier text, Gurblas Pasha Ishimi, in chapter 19 of that text, if anybody wants to cross-reference. That text comes about 100 years prior to Guru Pratap Suraj, and both of these texts have not been translated in English, which is unfortunate. But it is the reason why now I'm doing this podcast in English, to give people an idea about these stories. And where we're going to pick up now is chapter 37, where Bidhi Chand is now riding back to Bairupa village to give this horse to Guru Hargobind. So as he's riding out, he is in, you know, such bliss as he's riding. The text talks about how as he's riding, he's singing this Shabad, this passage written by Guru Arjan Dev Ji in Rag Asa. The gist of the Shabad, you know, Bidhi Chand, the context of it as well, is that Bidhi Chand has, you know, accomplished the impossible here. He's been able to deceive the court, you know, the highest emperor of the land, and right to their face as well. So having accomplished such a, you know, mighty feat, Bidhi Chand, as he's riding out, he's giving thanks to the guru for providing help, for acting through him to be able to accomplish this. So the Shabad basically describes how the divine provides protection, provides help, assistance to their devotees. So the Shabad, if anybody wants to look it up, this is on page 403 of the Guru Granth Sahib. Kavi Santokh Singh, the author of this text, has put the entire Shabad in, talking about how Bidhi Chand is singing the Shabad. The Shabad is, apne sevak ki ape rakhe, ape naam japave. Jai jai kaj kirt sevak ki, taha taha uthtave. Sevak ko nikti hoi dhkhave, jo jo kahe thakur pe sevak tatkal hoi aave. So that's the first portion of the Shabad. The entire Shabad is listed, and like I said, just a brief summary of that is that it's delineating agency of the actor here. So basically, Bidhi Chand is not taking any responsibility for such an amazing feat that he's accomplished here, and he's saying that it rather is the divine that's acting through me to accomplish such a feat. So it shows the state of mind that Bidhi Chand is in as he's riding down. He's giving thanks to the guru for being able to accomplish this. And like previously on his mission with the first horse, he's riding, and the text was talking about how he's avoiding villages as he's going down to make sure that nobody sees him, that he's not going to run into any obstacles there. The text talks about how Bidhi Chand is riding at great speed with the horse, but at the same time he's giving time for the horse to rest, as he understands that this horse has been in the stable for a very long time, and it's not had much practice, much exercise basically with riding. And in this is describing how Bidhi Chand is such an amazing rider, and that he is, you know, he has an intuitive understanding about the well-being of the horse. He's taking care of it on the way. Really shows a kind of a caring attitude that Bidhi Chand has to this horse as well. So like I mentioned, it talks about how, you know, a great distance is being covered now in such a short amount of time by Bidhi Chand, because he's such a great rider. And as he approaches the village of Bairupa with Guru Hargobind, he notices that there's no tents there. you know, the camp set up by the guru and his warriors is no longer there. So he has this doubt in his mind. He's wondering. He sees somebody in the village and approaches them and asks them, is the guru not residing here anymore? And if, like, if he went anywhere, please let me know. The villager tells him that because of the consistent request by Jodhrai, the other Sikh of Guru Hargobind, who lives not far from Bairupa, that Guru Hargobind has gone to Jodhrai's village. Bidhi Chand becomes really happy because he realizes this is not that far. He does a little prayer to the guru and then sets off. So the village he is heading to is called Gangar, and this is about, it's not too far from Bairupa. But Bidhi Chand, when he's about 4 kilometers away from the city, from the small village, he actually gets off the horse and he's grabbing the reins, and it describes the reins being made out of silk. And he just walks his way then to Gangar out of respect for the guru. So when he sees the camp up ahead in the village, he does a salutation and he begins walking there. As he's walking, he hears the sounds of different rags being recited. So there's a kirtan, there's devotional poetry being recited, and he sees that the guru is sitting there in the congregation court with Jodhrai beside him. The text then talks about how Guru Hargobind is sitting there in the congregation and he's thinking that, oh, Bidhi Chand should be arriving soon with the horse. And as he's thinking this, he sees Bidhi Chand and he gets up immediately. And they see each other and then they meet. Bidhi Chand bows down to the Guru's feet. He's, you know, quite happy that he's able to now bring the horse to the Guru. The Guru raises Bidhi Chand by his arms and gives Bidhi Chand a very big hug. He then says to Bidhi Chand that, you know, you've done such a great task. You know, you've accomplished the impossible here. Basically, you've put like a massive debt on my head because of this. Like, I owe a lot now to you. So whatever blessing you want, whatever gift you want, let me know. I can give that to you. Bidhi Chand's really humbled by this. He puts his hands together and says, you know, Guru, you are basically everything. You yourself cause people to do their action. You yourself put the debt on people. You repay this debt. You take the debt away. You've already given me everything. And the biggest gift that you've given me is that you gave me the gift of being desireless. So I don't really want anything here. But he says, if you are going to give me anything, then give me that blessing that, you know, I always have the pleasure, I always have the flavor, the basically you always color me in meditation of your name. And that the rest of my life I spend it with saints and holy people. So the guru listening to this was very happy, and he says to everybody a very famous phrase, Bidhi Chand Chinna Guru Ka Sina. So Chinna is the last clan name of Bidhi Chand. So the guru here is saying that Bidhi Chand is the very form of the guru. And the form, Sina, can mean body, but it can also mean, it specifically and technically, it means chest. So it can also mean that Bidhi Chand is the strength of the guru, or Bidhi Chand, in a more vernacular way of saying it nowadays, is the muscle of the guru. You know, Bidhi Chand, let's not forget, I have not covered these stories yet. In the previous battle episodes of Guru Hargobind, Bidhi Chand is described in great detail about his bravery, how he's able to, you know, how amazing archer he is and a swordsman. So in one of the stories, actually, Bidhi Chand gets a spear to the arm and even then is able to use his bow and arrow to take out, I guess, his enemy there on the battlefield. So this famous phrase is said by Guru Hargobind that Bidhi Chand is the strength of the guru, and he's always imbued with this essence of the guru. He's totally devoid of any sin or any fault. And Guru Hargobind then also says that he also makes me feel at bliss. He always makes my heart feel at bliss. He can accomplish any task with ease, like any difficult task is not a problem to him. And he utilizes his very powerful intellect when performing any task for the Guru. So very lofty praise is given from Guru Hargobind to Bidhi Chand, and it ends with him saying that, you know, how far can I continue to praise Bidhi Chand? But nobody is equal to Bidhi Chand. You know, he deceived the entire court of the emperor, and nobody can understand his level of wit or cunningness or intellect. So following this praise, you know, as Guru is praising Bidhi Chand, other senior Sikhs are there in the scene as well, Jetha, Jodhrai, and they all hear this and they all start to praise Bidhi Chand as well. So then after all this praise, Guru Hargobind takes the new horse, Gulbag, and reunites it with the other companion horse, Dilbag. Dilbag in previous episodes had been renamed by Guru Hargobind as Janpai, and the other horse, Gulbag, also will be renamed in the future as well. So when they see each other, these horses, they actually let out like this long neigh. A neigh is that characteristically high-pitched laugh, scream, noise that these horses make when they're very happy. And so it describes the text in detail about how affectionate these horses are with each other, that they're reunited. So they're touching each other on the nose, they've kind of massaged each other with their necks. And Guru Hargobind then is really happy about this. Then he gets Jetha, another Sikh, to massage the horses, provide it food, and take care of it. So then Guru Hargobind takes Bidhi Chand by the arm and he walks him into the larger congregation, larger court there that they had set up. And the Guru asks Bidhi Chand to tell the entire story from start to finish to the congregation there. So the last maybe 15-20 verses of the chapter, the author, Kavi Santokh Singh, has provided a very quick summary coming from the mouth of Bidhi Chand, talking about how he sold the first horse, you know, how he went back and sold the second horse. And at the end of that story, when Bidhi Chand recites this to the congregation, he says, you know, all of this I have done, but I would not have been able to do it without the Guru's support and help blessings. So I take no responsibility for this. This is all achieved. You know, I may be the vessel, but the Guru is the actor. And this mimics the Shabad at the start, the passage at the start of the story. As Bidhi Chand is writing down, he's singing this Shabad that also speaks to that mentality about not taking responsibility and realizing that the Guru is acting through you. So that's where this chapter ends. And as a consequence of the stealing the horses, the next chapter begins with battle preparations. So they know that war is now on their doorstep, and in the next chapter, Guru Hargobind with Jodhrai start deliberating as to the plans for battle tactics and where to set up camp best to give a strong opposition to the forces that are going to come from Shah Jahan. And that's what we'll pick up next time. We'll see you then. Sir,